Hello and welcome to DJ Mag Panels. Today we're joined by New Jersey house pioneer Kerry Chandler.
Hello.
Welcome, Kerry. Nice to see you. How are you doing?
Excellent. I'm having a wonderful time.
Good. So this week sees the release of your contribution to the highly respected DJ Kicks mix series, featuring everything from jazz, down-tempo house, to hip-hop, to reggae and funk, all blended together with skill and precision in the Kerry Chandler way. It's a warm and personal insight into your musical world and your influences and your background. Before we talk directly about the mix, because there's such a huge amount that goes into it, could you please tell us a little bit about your background and your introduction to music? You started out making hip-hop when you lived in East Orange, New Jersey. Is that correct?
That's correct. My background is, for a lot of music, comes from my dad. My dad was a huge influence on me. He's a DJ, and he just passed away the end of last year. But growing up, this is the kind of stuff that we'd always, you know, hear and play, and it was just something that I always loved, and that style, you know, he would play it in the clubs, and the same kind of way I grew up. This is the stuff we heard either on the radio, it's like Frankie Crocker would play it, or like, you know, we'd run home and hear like some stuff on the radio, and you get your cassette tape out and, you know, try to get all the tracks you really wanted to hear, then, you know, go track them down someplace.
So what was it that sort of stuck out from those days growing up? Sort of, what's it, jazz was it in particular, or classical, or funk? Or?
Oh, everything. I mean, that's the cool thing. You never know what you were going to really hear. I mean, it wasn't really a category. It's just good music, period. You know, and you never knew where it was going to come from. And we listened from everything from classical, because I had to play. I had to take piano lessons, and it was classical, which was really tough and, you know, stringent. And I had a German piano teacher, so she was really disciplined. And, you know, but then I have a few musicians in my family that are jazz musicians. So, you know, these things are.
Right. And what about making hip hop? What was it like growing up in your neighborhood? And then what was it about hip hop that you first liked and maybe kind of went away from?
Well, growing up in my neighborhood, I mean, East Orange was always just, we always had crews and battles and who DJs better than who. And, you know, a lot of influence came from like New York, and everybody was like, you know, B-boys and, you know, hip hop, and they, you know, train bombing, and, you know, a lot of artists, a lot of, you know, MCs. Everybody just wanted to be like cool. Like, you know, everybody wanted to rock the party. So we all kind of had crews, and we all like had, you know, turntables, and we all battled each other, and we all, whoever was the best, we took each other's gear, you know, and it was that kind of thing. So if you lost, you actually really lost something. You didn't just lose, you lost like a turntable or a mixer or something. So
it's quite mean.
Yeah, I made it a point never to lose.
So, yeah,
right. So I'll stay practicing and practicing and practicing. But it was kind of like we made our own parties in a way. There were a lot of basement parties, a lot of where we grew up in the ghetto areas, there was a lot of rent parties, a lot of basement rent parties. And we just had needed some outlets and fun, you know, when other people were doing drugs and whatever, we wanted to just have some fun and, you know, make a way. You know, it's not like it was like a trendy thing or something we just really enjoyed. And you'd always make your first record, your best record, all the way to the last record.
Right, so a lot of it was it kind of turntablism and kind of
absolutely
battling that kind of got you into it. Yeah. So how did that progress into house? Because obviously the style of DJing is a bit different.
We always played disco, and we always played like, you know, early hip hop together. It was never really a separation. Mm-hmm. That all happened some other place or some other club, but it was always soul. It was always disco. There was always like, you know, beginnings of hip hop, and it just people rocking over things. We had musicians coming in playing, you know, saxophones and whatever, the horns and things over tracks. So it was always just, that's the way it was. It didn't do anything different than, you know, what I saw my dad doing. And he had like, you know, the guys from Kool and the Gang playing at the party, or like Pick Connolly, for instance, from Surface. He would come in with like his flute and stuff, and he would just play over the tracks. And
wow,
you know, it was just like, it was always a jam session, and I never knew what was going to happen. And I'd warm up for my dad at this club.
And how old were you then?
13.
Right. And when was that, kind of in the 70s?
It was just very, very early 70s, beginning of 80s.
Right, yeah. So that's kind of where you cut your teeth as a DJ.
Yeah.
And then how did house come about off the back of all of that?
Well, the first time I heard anything that sounded like house, it was this this guy named Brown, and he played at my dad's club. It sounded like he took one of these Casio machines And I want to say it sounded like Find a Way, like Russ Brown Find a Way, or something back, way back. And I was just like, what is this? He's playing this thing off of reel to reel. And I'm like, what is that? It doesn't sound like, you know, normal disco stuff I've been hearing. It just sounds electronic in a weird way. Even though there was electronic stuff coming out of like Germany, and there's like Klein and MBO and all that kind of stuff. But that really made me go like, whoa, okay, that sounds like somebody made this at their house. You know, I didn't realize it was something, you know, called house music or anything at the time. So
right, yeah. Yeah. So it's quite raw.
Yeah, it was just
raw.
So
was that Chicago house, would you say, that you heard? Or
I didn't really hear Chicago house until I started hearing like Adana stuff like back in the 80s.
Right. So was that stuff you're describing more kind of, like you say, was it more of a German influence?
Yeah, but I was a kid. I didn't care. I just wanted something that sounded cool.
Yeah, sure. So I suppose for you, house has kind of been a good way of you kind of pinning together or bringing together all of the influences that I suppose you've explored on the mix.
Oh, yeah.
But even in your house productions, your deep house productions, there's a lot of kind of piano keys that you play live. There's obviously a musical background to it. So I suppose house has been a good way of you, a good way of you bringing in all of your different influences together. Would you say that's...
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I the funny thing is I always joke about it, and I say my hobby became my job and my job became my hobby. I began pretty much as an engineer, and I used to intern at a television studio first.
Right.
And I became, after a while, the engineer and the one of the producers at the TV station. Then I began, DJing on the weekends, you know, just because, I mean, I'd go in pretty much like we had punch cards, like check cards. It was a place called Club America. And then we rotate and we go to Zanzibar. So back and forth, it's like we were residents, but the meaning of our resident compared to what it is today, it's like you had to know everything to the point where you had to know the lights. You had to know all the amps, the systems. I mean, to the point where you had to keep everything in the booth clean. You had to make sure all the amps worked. You had to know the system. So the next person that was coming in who was the guest or an artist or something, they would know, you know, they would be set up nicely, you know, and comfortable and, you know, what was going on.
Presumably that's where you met DJs like Tony Humphries and...
Yeah, I mean, but that was it. It's just like we'd always rotate each other's club. There was a guy called Miles Berger that did three clubs. One was Club 88, Club America, and then Zanzibar.
Yeah.
And then what would happen, depending on who was not around, and there was Bert at 88. It was me and Johnny Dangerous and Naeem Johnson at 88. And then Tony and Hippie Torales over at Zanzibar.
Yeah.
So depending on who was out of the country or moving around, we'd all rotate to the other club.
Cool. So you've got quite a few interesting stories from over the years. Is it true you once played with Prince?
Oh yeah, that was fun. That was interesting because I wasn't expecting that at all.
So I was
a friend of mine, Marcus Wyatt. He does this party called Deep Out in L.A. And Prince just happened to be at the party one day. And
was he looking to find out about a track that you'd made? Or?
Yeah, it was just odd because I was playing with the saxophone player. We were doing Rain, and it was like Sting saxophone player. I can't remember his name right now. I just met him. I just said, yeah, let's just do this thing. So apparently, I guess Prince was watching, and he had his crew with him, his entourage. So Marcus comes up to me, and he says, hey, Kerry, you know, Prince is here. I said, really? So I'm looking around, I'm like, you're joking. I thought he was joking with me. He says, no, he's here. He's behind, you know, he's right there behind you. I said, he looks at me, he's like, I think he wants to play. I said, no, he says, he's got that look in his eye. He looks like he wants to play. And then sure as shit, he walks up. And I was like, shit, it's really Prince. I thought it was like somebody, like, you know, somebody was joking with me. He has this orange and white suit. I mean, looked good. The man looked good, but it was just like really short, but it was like, he looked like someone could shrink someone. Like a person.
Yeah.
He asked me, he's like, what key is the song in? I looked at him, I said, whatever fucking key you want the song to be in, you do what you want. So then he literally turned over to the keyboard.
Yeah.
And he just started playing keys over top of the tracks.
Wow.
I was just standing, I'm looking at Marcus, I'm like, I don't believe I'm even seeing this. Like, what? Wow.
Am I dreaming?
Like, yeah, I'm like, yeah. And then he turned around and just gave me a hug and then, you know, just the thank you went back.
So was this in partying. This was in a club? Presumably?
Yeah, this is in LA at a place called Deep.
Wow, people must have just been like,
oh, it was crazy.
Shocked.
The one thing that he did do that made me laugh because I didn't realize is he made everyone like put away cell phones and everything and
really
had his entourage like make sure nobody was watching.
Right. So when was this? This was
maybe six, 7 years ago.
Wow. Amazing. Yeah. And also, you also played, hasn't Femi Kuti played horns?
Oh. Well, I gotta blame Jerome for this one. This is
okay. Jerome's sitting in the back over there.
The interesting story. Well, Jerome is not Nigerian. I mean, I wish he could. Jerome tells a much better story about this kind of thing, but I guess I'll try my
next
best.
Next time on DJ Mag panels.
Well, God, Femi.
So a fellow QT's son, the Afrobeat legend.
Yeah. What ended up happening was, and this is so cool how it all went. It was unexpected. But Jerome has all of these roots in Nigeria.
Right.
And he knows all the stuff about Fela. And, you know, he was kind of educating me at the time about it. So we did this song called Lagos Jump. And came out, I did pretty well. I guess it got enough attention to grab Femi's eye and the label. So they said, yeah, why don't you guys do it? You know, we want to, you know, can you do the mix for him? I was like, hell yeah, of course. So I went back and did all of it. And in the meantime, Jerome actually knew everyone anyway. I didn't realize how well he knew everyone. So he just happened to be in Paris at the same time we were doing some club. I think it was called Queen. Was it Queen Club? And he was in concert doing this concert the same night. And he came in to see all of us. And I was just like, and he was like, do you have your horn in the car with you? And he's like, yeah, let's go get it. I said, yeah, let's do it here. Let's do it live here at the club. And he's just like, yeah, okay, I'll be right back. And he just came back in the club, handed him a mic, and that was it. And he just nailed it. Like, oh,
that's
he was
incredible.
There for like a good hour.
And just jamming
along. And I had my keys and, you know, me and Jerome and Cyril, like Deep, were just playing records. I mean, he was just jamming over everything. And we did Rain together.
Wow, yeah. That must have been awesome.
Yeah, it was crazy.
Let's recreate it one day.
Yeah.
So we'll bring things a bit more up to date. You run three labels still.
Yeah.
The original Madhouse Records from 1992 still releasing music. And you've got a spin-off, Mad Tech, which has pioneered a lot of UK artists, including Voyeur. And also, you've also recently, fairly recently, 2015, started the Chaos Theory label.
Correct.
I just wanted to know a little bit about how you separate between those three.
Oh, that's pretty easy. I mean, Madhouse has always been a soulful vocal label, and this is his 25th year anniversary now.
Cool.
And that wasn't just my baby. That was my heart. It still is. Mad Tech I started because I met a lot of younger kids in a generation that needed an outlet. And I always thought that, you know what, if I had I had somebody to help me out, champion, which is Mel, to spring me off. So I figured I'd do the same thing that, you know, he did for me for other kids coming into the business. Mm-hmm. So that's what Mad Tech actually is. It's a springboard for the next generation. Like, you know, when I started, I was green. So for me, it's like me handing off experience and all these things that I wanted to, you know, show the next generation coming in and they can go on and do their thing as well. As far as Chaos Theory is more of the, I used to do all of these dubs called Chaos 623 again. And I've always loved the feel of that. But every time I've gone to like Ibiza, instead of the full tracks and vocals and things that I used to do, I wanted it to make it more of a track, tougher sound that I was doing all the dubs I was doing with. And I said, you know, I've got to do a label like that makes sense, because it's like everyone in Ibiza has been playing the same. I didn't have to change anything when I went to Circle. Mm-hmm. I just kind of played the same way when I make dubs, and just a little tougher with the tone I like, but I always like the darker tones. So that's why I started Chaos Theory. And it's kind of the same way, since we became really close with all the people, you know, with Circle, I figured, well, let's just all do a comp together and make it jump. And we all trade each other's mixes off. We always play each other's things. So,
because it launched as a compilation, didn't it, of various artists?
Yeah, and that's what it was. And I thought it'd be really fun to, you know, just feature everyone I you know, knew after a few years. Like,
cool.
We're all very close.
That kind of leads me on to my next question about, I suppose, you mentioned the Chaos Theory is a good way of kind of expressing and exploring some of the stuff that you're playing out, because you're DJing now as much as you ever were.
The busiest I've ever been, yeah.
And playing at like really cool parties like Circa Loco. You play for us at Egg London, and you're always playing all over the UK and Europe and the US. What's the secret to staying relevant when it comes to house music over the years?
The truth of it is, there's no magic wand for it. I just kind of try to keep consistent and just try to keep the quality as high as I can go. And I've never tried to be better than anyone. I've always tried to just be the best me. And thank God I have a lot of friends that just don't take any garbage from me. And they keep me very grounded. You know, if something is wrong, they'll tell me immediately, like Jerome. It's like, if something sounds crazy, you're like, no. You know, he's always been that thing. He's always been like the person to push me. And I think that's very important to have friends in your corner saying, like, they can look at you and go like, well, I think that you need to be doing this instead of that.
Right.
You know, this is good. I'm glad you did that. But I think you need to move a little more in this direction than that direction. So it's like, you know, it's nice to bounce thoughts off of each other. And we are very brutal with each other when it comes to music.
Honest. Yes. Yeah. So I suppose Circa Loco's fitted quite nicely into it in terms of its music policy and the style you feel free to play there.
Oh, yeah. No, completely. I mean, the first party I did there was kind of a test run at the end of this, one of the seasons. And I just said, I don't know, because I wasn't thinking I would feel Ibiza at all. I was just like, oh, what the hell? And they kept saying, you need to come to play our closing party. And I was like, okay, well. And I said, you know, and I kept thinking, Ibiza, bottle service, you know, just not my scene, really. And he said this one thing that convinced the crap out of me when I was talking to Andreas. He says, we don't have a VIP service. He says, all we have is a really great sound system and red lights. And I said, what? What do you mean? He says, yeah, just a really good sound system and some red lights. I said, that's been all my life. You know, it's like basement red light in the field. And I said, you just said the magic word.
Yeah, I'm in.
And yeah, I said, let me go try it. And I tried it and it just clicked. And I've been there ever since.
Yeah. You spend most of the summer there.
Yeah.
Whole season. Okay, let's talk a little bit about the mix that's coming out this week for DJ Kicks on K7. Did you have a particular approach or angle to the way you collected the tracks and put it together?
Well, again, it's like everyone probably would expect me to do a DJ mix, like a normal house mix, or go in there. I've done that for so many years. It's been 30 years of that. So I wanted to do something that was more of my influence and where I began from. And yeah, just kind of show the influence I actually had. So, I mean, I must have picked about 150 records. And this is what, you know, got licensed in the end and some of these other things. But picking through all that stuff was really, really tricky.
How long did it take?
Months. Really, it took months to actually get the ones I wanted back. And the ones I couldn't get, I had to substitute
right. For
other things that I thought would sound similar to what the feel was that I wanted. And my whole premise was I wanted to make you feel like if you came to New York, it's like if you put your headphones on, that it would take you through a walk through New York, you know, where we grew up and like all the areas, Newark, Brooklyn, East Orange, Soho, all the way up, you know, Uptown, Midtown, you know, all the clubs we used to frequent, the Tunnel, you know, Bobby Condors and all these things that we always used to do, you know, Nell's, which is Jerome again. And same thing again. And I had so much of a hard time again, and this is again having such great friends, that I was looking at the list for so long and so hard, I had such a hard time trying to figure out what the arrangement was.
Right.
So again, I called on, you know, Jerome, like Jerome helped me with Trusty this damn Jerome. Arrangement to figure it all out, you know, and I was just like, I need to sort this whole thing out. I'm so familiar with it now that I can't take myself away from the equation. And that's, you know, that was it. When he sent it back, it was maybe about a week. We were both sorting it back and forth. And I mean, he was so badass. He actually did the album vinyl arrangement as well, how it should go, because he used to work at Atlantic and he was like one of the A&R guys there. So I trust his judgment as well as anything. So when I ask his opinion, he's like, oh yeah, this is what it should be.
You got it
daily, yeah, all the time. Great advice all the time. But that's where we left it. And I looked at it and there was a few more things I had to stick in because I was just like, okay, I got to make this at least 80 minutes. And we just went and went and went. And I kept going through it and everything fell into place the way it was. And what I didn't want to do, and I said this, I wanted to keep everything as pure as it was at the right tempo. I didn't want anything to go above pitch or below pitch. Mm-hmm. So I made it exactly how the record is for the tempo. And I found different ways to go into it. So I'd make an interlude to go in between things, about to play keyboards or something. But I didn't want to pitch something down into something or mix something into something, because I wanted it to feel like, okay, you're walking through town. Oh, there we are. We're going to go to this bar here. Oh, we're going to go this here. We're going to see the sights, you know. And it's really a story of where I live.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So yeah, a real kind of love letter to your kind of upbringing.
Yeah, it's almost like if your friend is making you, but we used to do mixtapes for each other years ago, and like, here's this cassette, I want you to have it.
So it tells a story.
Yeah.
Wow, that's amazing. Well, if you haven't got it already, go out and buy it or download it on K7, DJ Kicks, Kerry Chandler. It's been an absolute honor having you here.
Oh, thank you so much again. Thank you guys for all the support all these years too.
Thank you.